Good afternoon and welcome back to the 16th meeting of this committee in 2020. Agenda item 2 is evidence taking on the complaints handling phase of the inquiry. I won't repeat my comments from the start of today's meeting in the interest of keeping to time, but I refer witnesses, members and all those watching proceedings to that statement. With that, can I welcome Nicola Richards, Director of People at the Scottish Government. And I begin by inviting Ms Richards to take the solemn affirmation. If you would raise your right hand, please, Ms Richards. And repeat after me. I solemnly, sincerely and truly declare and affirm that I will tell the truth, the whole truth and nothing but the truth.
I solemnly, sincerely and truly declare and affirm that I will tell the truth, the whole truth and nothing but the truth.
Thank you very much, and may I now invite Ms Richards to make an opening statement.
Thank you, Convener. I offer some brief opening words to provide context about my role in the handling of complaints and the basis on which I'm providing answers today. I am Director of People in the Scottish Government and have been in post since May 2016. In January 2018, two women came forward with formal complaints about sexual harassment that had to be investigated. The Scottish Government has a legal responsibility, a duty of care to all employees to ensure a safe place of work and protection against harassment. The behaviour alleged amounted to potentially unlawful treatment and discrimination, contrary to the Equality Act, as well as a possible breach of the employment policies and practices of the Scottish Government. The Scottish Government had a duty to investigate these formal complaints and a duty to ensure we had appropriate policies and procedures in place. From the experience to date, including the judicial review, there has been considerable learning. We will continue to identify and apply lessons as a result of this inquiry and the external review led by Laura Dunlop QC, with a goal of ensuring that harassment has no place in our organisation. As Director of People, I have a wide range of responsibilities. These are primarily of strategic direction and management oversight across our people functions, and also to support the Permanent Secretary and her executive team on workforce matters. During the process of handling the complaints, my role under the procedure was to designate a senior civil servant as the investigating officer, and as Judith McKinnon's line manager, in her wider role as head of legal of people advice, we had regular check-ins where I would be updated on her work, including high-level progress with the investigation. I'm giving evidence on behalf of ministers today and not in a personal capacity. As the committee will be aware, there is continuing dispute between the Scottish Government and Mr. Salmon's legal representatives about whether the decision report, suitably redacted, can be disclosed to the committee. I'm advised that while that dispute continues, there may be certain questions which I cannot answer, as to do so may risk breaching the undertaking and amount to contempt of court. If I am concerned that I might breach that undertaking or at any point risk identifying the complainers, then I will have to decline to answer at this time and come back to you in writing so that the impact of the contempt of court order can be fully considered. I will also do that to ensure accuracy on matters of detail. I remain a member of the FDA. Thank you, Convener.
Thank you very much, Ms Richards. I'll move straight on to questions from the committee. And first of all, Margaret Mitchell.
Thank you, Convener, and good afternoon, Ms Richards. The last time you appeared before committee, I asked you whether the role of the confidants still existed, and you said you would need to check, but suggested it may still be on the Scottish Government internet. This morning, it's been confirmed that the role of confidant does still exist, but has not been actively promoted since August 2019. Can you explain why not?
I think probably two reasons for that. One is to confirm that the confidential sounding board role, whilst I think a very helpful development and something that we would certainly want to keep in place looking ahead, there is also an employee assistance programme, so there is a confidential helpline that's independent of Scottish Government that's open 24/7 for employees to go to. So there is always a mechanism there outside of the sounding board role. I think I'd also say from August 2018, once the police process had begun, I think that organisationally there was a lot of concern about doing anything that might be misconstrued or misunderstood whilst the criminal proceedings and the police investigation was underway. So I think organisationally we were very, very cautious actually about doing anything that might be seen even inadvertently or obliquely to refer to those proceedings. So I think that made us more cautious perhaps about promoting things like the sounding board, specifically around things like sexual harassment.
Wouldn't it have been better just to remove it from the internet so there'd be no dubiety if you were concerned about using the confident? Because let's face it, it had been very effective. People did come forward, they did discuss their concerns.
I think it wasn't something that we wanted to remove, and many people who came forward with issues to Mr. Russell were not about ministers, they were just routine, you know, relatively routine issues about other civil servants.
Yeah. Can I go a little bit further and say that the way this was handled does appear to be a bit of a failing on the part of HR, if this was good practice, and certainly the Permanent Secretary suggested the very first time she came to the committee that it was good practice. It should have been continued at that point. That was very early on in the inquiry. Then it was a failing on both the Permanent Secretary and HR part that it wasn't actively promoted. It was an informal role, it wasn't part of the process. And can I go further? Does it not leave the impression that the role of confidant was introduced in November 2017 for a specific purpose, and that by August 2018 that purpose had been achieved and therefore it wasn't considered important, despite it being put in place allegedly to assure staff that their concerns would be taken seriously and would be dealt with efficiently and effectively?
I think that the fact that the role continued to be available to people was clear, and it was there and remains on the intranet. I don't interpret that as a failing, and there are other mechanisms by which people could come forward. And it wasn't the case that it was put in place for a particular purpose. Sir Jeremy Hayward had written to the Permanent Secretary suggesting that those kinds of mechanisms might be valuable. It was a particular moment in time, very intense moment around the Me Too movement, and I think at that moment there was an explosion of interest and people coming forward with issues right across the board about a number of incidents, past and present. And I think after that initial wave, that faded. But I don't think that had anything at all in relation to the specific allegations about the former First Minister.
But we're talking 2 years later, and that's almost your explanation suggesting that sexual harassment has disappeared, no longer a problem. That could be a possible interpretation, could it not, from what you've just told me?
I don't believe so.
Yeah, well, I don't think it would be an accurate one. And we've heard what you said in that. Can I ask you a little bit about whether you were involved in discussions on the referral to the police?
I was involved I think it was kind of early August time, 2018, about potential referral to the police. There was obviously a lot of consideration going on at that point at a senior level in the organisation about the responsibilities and duty on us as an organisation to consider the matters, some of which might potentially amount to criminal activity. And clearly that's a big consideration for an organisation to come to refer the matters to the police. It wasn't my decision to refer. It wouldn't be a decision that I was asked to make. My role in that was to try and understand the position of the complainers so that and their views could be played into those considerations and that decision.
And what was the complainer's view of the possibility of this being referred to the police?
I think it was very clear that it was not their wish, not their preference. It had not been, I think, where they had begun. I think they fully understood, and we were always clear, that it might be a judgment as an organisation that we had no choice but to refer the matters to the police, and they fully understood that. But to me and my role in it, it was to just accurately convey back the views of the complainers, and I think they were concerned. They were concerned about the impact on them. the potential impact on witnesses and others brought into that process, and they were concerned by the potential lack of loss of anonymity and confidentiality that might come from that.
So is it a fair assessment to say if there hadn't been in the route map the provision and the option for third-party referral, and the Scottish Government particularly to do that, then these complaints would never have gone to the police?
I think it probably goes beyond the procedure, that duty on public authorities to consider if they become aware of a potential criminal act, that they would alert the police to that. I remember discussions and precedents that were discussed, for example, for universities where they may become aware of a potential sexual assault occurring between their students, for example, and they have to come to the conclusion that they will pass that information to the police, even if that's against the wishes of the individual. So I think for most public authorities, it's very challenging. Should you become aware of the credible risk that a criminal act may have taken place, to withhold that and to not share that with the police, I think would equally have been a very, very difficult thing to have done.
And would that have been the case when the incidents first happened? You know, it didn't need this procedure. If it was criminal, if something had been reported to a line manager, to a colleague, to anyone, would that not have been the case way back when these incidents first happened?
I wasn't involved at that time, so I can't give a sense.
But from your perspective as head of HR, director of people?
I think if it depends how the person individually, who they share that with, where that goes to, I think. I think if it had been shared with HR at that time, then potentially they would have felt that they needed to take that action, but that would be hypothetical on my part.
Yeah. Can finally ask you just how this matter was raised with the police, that actual referral?
When the Scottish Government came to the conclusion that it needed to refer matters to the police, having taken the views of the complainers, which we fed into account, I didn't at any point have direct contact with the police. And didn't share the details of a complaint or even the fact of a complaint directly with the police at any point during proceedings. I was asked to share our information with the Crown Office, so I passed the information to the Crown Office. I think that was kind of late August time, 2018, and it would have then been for the Crown Office to decide which of that they chose to share with Police Scotland.
And the actual discussions, had they taken place earlier? Would that have been end of July? I think maybe Ms. Russell referred to her passing on information to you about them. End of July, that the discussions about the referral or possible referral took place, and then the actual referral took place later on. Is that the kind of time frame we're looking at?
Yes, sir, but it didn't involve Ms. Russell.
No, but she passed information to you, but that wasn't anything to do with the referral, just on the complainer had given her permission to pass on and contact to you, no?
No, that was much earlier. So that was in November 2017.
Yes, so you're right.
Following Ms. Russell's first contact with the complainers, that she then passed that on. So, yeah. So, no, she wasn't involved at that point
yes,
at all.
Yes, you're right. But, okay. Yeah. Thank you very much for clarifying that.
Myrtle Fraser.
Thank you, Convener. Good afternoon, Ms. Richards. Can I just follow up on the questions that my colleague Margaret Mitchell just asked about the issue of police involvement? When we took evidence this morning from Judith McKinnon, she told us that you had asked her to sound out the complainers about the issue of going to the police. So firstly, is that correct? And if that is correct, can you tell us when that was?
Yes, that would have been correct. And essentially, that instruction was passed to me, and I was passing that instruction on to Judith. So at the point, as Ms. Mitchell was describing, I think probably late July, but mainly into August, as I recall, but I could check the specific dates. There was discussion going on at senior levels about whether there needed to be consideration given to referral to the police, and we were asked to understand the position of the complainers. And again, I think part of the thinking that has to go in by any public authority before it makes a referral of that nature is about the wishes, and particularly the kind of impact and well-being impact on the complainers. So from our perspective, either for Judith, and then I think after Judith went on leave, I picked up that engagement with them, was to just faithfully play back their views so that they could be taken into consideration. And as I understand it, that was all taken in the round, but the final conclusion was that these were serious issues and they were for the police to review.
Sure. Okay, thank you. And you say that that information was passed to you. Who gave that to you? Who gave the instruction to bring in the police?
There was a discussion. I'm not sure I can give all of the details, yeah. But the instruction was passed to me by the Permanent Secretary's office.
The Permanent Secretary. Okay, thank you very much. And, you know, we know from the evidence we've heard that the initial concerns were raised with Judith McKinnon in November 2017. Now, you're talking about these discussions around police involvement taking place in July, August 2018. I'm just wondering why the large time gap? Was it not obvious at a much earlier stage that these were very serious matters that might involve criminal activity?
And I think Gillian may have referred to it earlier, that I think in her early conversations, her very first conversations, I think, with Miss A, that the question, I think Gillian raised the question of it potential for kind of police engagement, and clearly the opportunity, if they wished, for the individuals to raise the matter directly with the police was always there. I mean, I suppose the difference between November and July, August, was that by that stage an investigation had taken place, so those allegations had been tested. So by that point it was, well, we've been through an internal process, we've tested these allegations, can we credibly not act on these now? So I think for us that was the difference, I think, between those two dates.
Okay, thank you. And my final question, if I can, when I put it to Judith McKinnon this morning that there was a reluctance on the part of the complainers to take this to the police, she didn't disagree with that. Would that be your own impression too?
Absolutely.
Yeah. Okay. Thank you. Thank you, Convener.
Angela Constance.
Thank you, Convener, and good afternoon to Ms. Richards. Throughout our investigation, committee has been confronted with the same names over and over again, and it appears that the same close group of civil servants seem to have been tasked with both developing the procedure, investigating the complaints under the procedure, and of course, in the case of the Permanent Secretary, coordinating the judicial review. So I wondered, do you think that some of the issues here could have been avoided if it had been different people involved in the different stages?
I mean, clearly it's kind of the nature of our roles, and I think that's probably part of the difficulty here, is that it's inevitably, in my role, lots of roads come to you and you have to take a view and support over a range of different issues. And obviously for the Permanent Secretary that's even more intense, in that, you know, everything eventually kind of flows in that direction, albeit her day-to-day involvement may not be so close. I think there are certainly, I think, things for us to reflect on, and I'm sure following this inquiry and following the Laura Dunlop review, opportunities to think about, well, are there moments, you know, do you want an independent process? Do you want to take things externally? Should you think about things from a different perspective? And I think we'd be, you know, very open to that kind of learning. I think there are, however, kind of other views, and I think the importance of confidentiality to everybody involved was incredibly intense, and therefore we it had to be kept very, very tight, had to be kept very close to make sure that confidentiality could be maintained. And I think sometimes, as we've seen with other research and reports, individuals can be quite reluctant to go beyond their organisation to an external body, and that can actually dissuade people from raising issues rather than make them feel safer. So it isn't always straightforward, but I absolutely accept that it's something that should be reviewed.
I suppose, committee, we're wrestling with the evidence that there was a rush to put this procedure in place, but there appears to be, with respect, less of a rush to implement learning. Perhaps I can maybe put the same point to you in a slightly different way. Do you not think that the fact that a small group of civil servants undertook the bulk of the work, you know, whether that was developing the procedure or handling the complaints, do you not think that creates a real risk that mistakes or the risk of mistakes was just not appreciated? And is there not the danger that, you know, it could appear that a small group of people who think they're doing the best or think they know best, that they undertook the largest part of this work with little outside influence? So where were the checks and balances? Where's the governance in all of this?
I mean, one thing I would reiterate is the fact that we took legal advice throughout. So there were many moments, I think, where you kind of step back and seek advice and reflect on what should be done. I obviously we remain open to views and recommendations about different ways of going about it. I think it's quite challenging, though, to really kind of work through how that would work in practice. You know, it's not, if you've got a very, very sensitive issue that's raised by somebody, you know, it doesn't really feel like you could have a gateway review. So, you know, it's sort of trying to think about, well, what would happen? And, you know, a genuine question, because I think it is something that all of us are keen to keep working through. Well, what might you do differently in these kinds of circumstances? But generally, they do only evolve a very small number of people. And that's part of the, you know, the requirement that you do keep it very, very restricted in that way.
People appreciate that there has to be that most consideration to confidentiality. But picking up about what you've said about all roads leading to a small group, all roads leading to the permanent secretary, given her role in, you know, developing the procedure and overseeing the complaints, the judicial review and whatnot, do you not think that there is a risk here, that there is therefore too much control in the hands of one person?
Personally, no. I think that, you know, that's the way organisations operate. You have the person who's, you know, kind of ultimately responsible for an organisation, and they have to set a direction. They're not necessarily involved very closely in kind of every step of the way. But I think, as the permanent secretary set out here, she's never shirked that responsibility. But I think that is just, you know, just the nature of any organisation, really, is that you have somebody who is in that kind of position. But again, if it's deemed that it's preferable, actually, for complaints of this kind of nature to be handled entirely independently, then I don't think any of us would say that shouldn't be something that we would look at.
And what consideration has been given in the past to an independent process, particularly around the complaints investigation process? Because surely that would have, you know, guaranteed that the investigating officer, you know, wasn't involved in the development of the policy, wasn't involved in other aspects of this journey. So what consideration, you know, was there any serious consideration to an independent investigation process?
I think when the procedure was being developed, it was a consideration, but I think actually, given all of the advice that came together at that time, and certainly the sort of legal and other view, I think, was that actually you have things like an employment tribunal, that's your place in an employment process, that you can go for that independence. And actually, in most of those kinds of circumstances, the expectation is that you have exhausted all internal routes for resolving an issue before you go externally. And I think the view in terms of the risk to confidentiality and everything else was that actually this needed to have a level of internal process. But as I say, it may be that practice has moved on and thinking is now in a different place in terms of having a fully independent process, but that wasn't the view that was reached at that time.
So you think there's a merit in having an independent process that means the investigating officer has had no previous involvement with complainers, the procedure, or with the matters being investigated?
I think there's you can argue either way. I think you can see how there was clarity and confidence for complainers to understand and know the process that they were going to be embarking upon. There was advantages in terms of confidentiality and in being able to assure that not just for the complainers but also for the other party, and that was a very, very key consideration. And in terms of the role of the investigating officer, I mean, I think as we've tried to set out, and I know that's challenging, but it really wasn't a concern at the time in terms of the different roles that Ms. McKinnon had played were for us, I think, just purely different aspects of her HR professional role and not something that was a concern at that time. The Cabinet Office guidance from around that time was also clear that if these are complex historical issues that you're trying to review, that it might make sense for the investigation to be handled within HR. So, you know, this wasn't an unusual process and thing to go through. But as I say, you know, we'll continue to review that practice.
And my very final question, just for the record, and I'm sure this has been stated already, so forgive me. So you're Judith McKinnon's line manager, but with respect to the investigation, did Ms. McKinnon report direct to you or direct to the Perm Secretary?
I wouldn't say kind of. She produced a report for the Permanent Secretary, so that was absolutely the role in that in terms of the investigation. Not reported in a line management sense, but reported in terms of providing a report to the Permanent Secretary.
Thank you.
I understand Maureen Watt's questions are along the same theme.
Yes, thanks, Convener. Good afternoon, Ms. Richards. You said in reply to questions from Angela Constance that you took legal advice throughout. Is that throughout developing the procedure and investigating the complaints? And if so, from whom?
I'm unable to say from whom, but yes, we took legal advice throughout the development of the procedure, and it would have been for Ms. McKinnon rather than for me. But yes, legal advice was taken throughout the investigation.
And would it have been from the same team or people that were involved in the judicial review?
It will have been from SGLD.
Okay. In terms of developing the procedure and investigating complaints, as Ms. Constance said, it does seem to be a very small cabal of civil servants. So who thought it was a good idea to share the procedure with people who might then become complainants?
I wouldn't call it a cabal. I'd call it a group of senior colleagues. In terms of sharing the procedure with Ms. A, as I think we covered in evidence in previous sessions, the discussion at that time was that the procedure should be shared, could be shared with Ms. A, partly so that she understood the procedure that was likely to be followed in the way that you would with anyone who might be considering bringing an issue forward, so they understood the next steps, but also out of an interest in terms of if something like this had been in place at the time, would that have made a difference? Would that have helped matters? Would it have given them confidence to raise matters at the time? So it was really twofold.
We heard this morning that the Scottish Government went to the police and complainants or complainant were quite nervous about that. You know, thinking, I presume, as most people would, that the person who's involved should be the person doing it rather than an organisation or the employer. getting involved. Who took the decision that the Scottish Government should lodge a complaint with the police or let the police know what was happening?
I think that was taken by the Permanent Secretary taking all advice.
Okay, thank you.
Just before I move on to Andy Whiteman, to follow on from what Angela Constance was asking, you confirmed that you are Judith McKinnon's line manager. Can you refresh my memory as to who your own line manager is?
At the time, yes. Sarah Davidson.
Right. Ms Davidson came and gave us evidence about the judicial review part, and we heard about the report that she was asked to do and submit to the Permanent Secretary. Did she have any role at all as your line manager throughout the complaints handling process?
No kind of official role. I mean, very similar to the engagement I had with Judith. I would have, in my kind of regular catch-ups with her, would have, you know, talked in broad terms about the progress with the investigation, but not in any detail. And I don't think we really touched on it particularly at that time.
So she wouldn't have been in any form the decision maker about anything you had concerns about?
No.
So would that decision maker be the Permanent Secretary, and how much of it was autonomous to you?
How much of what?
Decision making, the major decisions, like you said, like involving the police, for example, was a decision taken by the Permanent Secretary. You know, what about sharing the draft policy with the complainers? Was that something you spoke to the Permanent Secretary about, or was that a decision that you felt unable to take in your own position?
I see what you mean. Obviously some decisions have more weight in hindsight than they might have done at the time. Certainly the sharing the procedure, and the Permanent Secretary was aware of that, and I think, you know, she felt that was something that was of value because it would inform matters, and particularly inform, I think, you know, were we doing the right things in terms of shifting the culture of the organisation? So not in any way related to the specific complaint, but just a more general thing. Certainly in terms of, I had no decision-making role in the investigation at all. So all of those decisions were for the Permanent Secretary.
Thank you. Andy Whiteman.
Thanks, Convener, and welcome, Ms Richards. In an email that you wrote to Judith McKinnon on the 6th of December, that's footnote 10 in document XX047, you said, "I've updated the timeline and this is the final version of the policy I've sent to PermSec." You then go and say, "Do you want to have a look at the timeline and see what you think?" You then go and say, "It might need testing back against the policy." Could you explain what that sentence means, "It might need testing back against the policy," please?
I do actually have the document in front of me, so I have been able to review that. And I think what that will have referred to at that point is we're starting then to project into the planning, you know. So if this person does decide to come forward with a formal complaint, what would we need to do? And we were trying then to sort of sketch out the stages that we would need to work through. So I think what I'm saying there is in the and there's an error in this document, which I think I may have corrected in earlier correspondence back to the committee. There's in the original document, the dates are wrong. It should flow into December, but they say November. And I think the bit which would be the 8th of December entry is trying to sort of set out that process. So I think it was saying, can we check back in terms of the policy that this would be the right kind of flow, that this would be the right kind of process? Have we missed any steps?
So, sorry, what is the policy?
Sorry, the procedure.
Okay, so what do the words of the policy mean?
That will mean the procedure.
The procedure, okay. I mean, in hindsight, you would probably rephrase that as against the procedure. Policy sounds like...
a wider thing. Yeah, again, I suppose these were passing emails,
sure,
between colleagues, so if, yep, I'd have known I was going to be explaining it 3 years later, I would have drafted it more clearly.
No, that's well understood. Thank you very much. If I could move on to the email, and this is in YY050, footnote 46, and this is an email of the 15th or 14th December to Ms. A from yourself and copying in Judith McKinnon and Nicola, well, copying in yourself, yeah, 14th December. You said to the, and I'll come back to that in a minute, you said to the committee on the 25th of August when you were here, you told the committee that not having a formal process didn't stop someone from raising a complaint. You then went on to say that complaints about third parties, and I'm quoting here, complaints about third parties, which is in essence what a minister or former minister would be in this instance, are a fairly routine part of other policies and are included in our fairness at work policy. Mr. Hind told the committee on that same day, on the 25th of August, that he had identified a gap in the fairness at work policy whereby complaints, there was no explicit provision for complaints against former ministers. But what you're saying there is that former ministers or former ministers would in this instance be third parties, and therefore the fairness at work policy could apply to a former minister, notwithstanding the fact that it didn't explicitly say so. That option wasn't given, or you didn't suggest that as an option to Ms. A in that email on the 14th of December. Was that just because you took the view that the policy then, the procedure then being developed and soon to be in force, would be much more robust, or why?
I mean, I think because it was close to completion and it would have been the relevant policy to deal with a harassment complaint of that nature. And I think, you know, in essence, perhaps both positions are correct. If you hadn't had any process at all, then I think you would have been constructing something, drawing on the kinds of approaches that would be taken when dealing with a third party, and applying the kind of legal requirements that you would need to work through in that kind of instance. Obviously, having something that had been thought through in relation to former ministers explicitly was helpful in that regard, because it meant that that thinking had been done, and it wasn't explicitly part of the Fairness at Work policy. But if we hadn't had the new procedure in place and hadn't had anything of that nature, then I think we would have had to look at Fairness at Work, look at the employment law around complaints against third parties, and come to a view on that. I mean, in essence, most employment policies, as this one, is fairly unremarkable. You know, it's a similar set of stages in terms of, you know, receiving the complaint, conducting the investigation, coming to a decision. So really the kind of the basic structure would remain the same.
Okay, thanks. In that email, you also say, I hope is all okay with you. We wanted to follow up on our conversation of last week. You then go and say, we've now spoken to two other people who are also considering their position. Can I take it that one of those two other people is the other complainer of the two? But there's a third person in this story. Presumably they didn't take things any further. Is that correct?
No, they decided not to pursue a formal complaint.
Okay. Was that a complaint against the former First Minister?
Yes, it was, yes.
Okay. Right. Could we... then go on the same email in the fourth paragraph. You talk about it being helpful to set out the options around the next steps for you to consider, and these draw upon our policies. In the case of it being a formal process, you say, then it's likely that Judith would take the role of the senior officer, given she had no involvement at the time and her professional experience. When you said she had no involvement at the time, what time is that you're referring to?
The time that the events took place.
So that's 2013 or 14 or 5 years, 4 or 5 years before, okay. Yeah. I mean, obviously the judicial review was conceded because of the court's interpretation of Section 10 and in relation to that, the words prior contact and what prior contact meant. And we heard from Judith McKinnon that she was behaving in all respects as she understood it to be her role, as the procedure had been, and that the new procedure was more sparse in its terms than the previous procedure had been written down as. Is it your understanding that having no prior contact is the same as having no involvement at the time. Are those two, is that synonymous?
Well, certainly that was absolutely, I think, the interpretation of everybody involved at the time of the development of the procedure, was that Section 10, you know, in the way that there's the ACAS guidance lays these things out, it talks about prior involvement with the matters being raised. So the matters of the complaint, the timing of the complaint. So, you know, that was absolutely our interpretation and understanding of that clause in line with other employment policies, was that you were, you know, that was about the time that the events took place. And so I think the difficulty potentially with all of this has been we were interpreting things based on employment law and employment practice around these kinds of processes. When you arrive at a judicial review setting, you are into the realms of public law and they have different requirements, different standards then apply. And I think that was the area where, you know, this different interpretation came through. But I would also highlight, as I think the Lord Advocate did in his evidence, that it wasn't actually prior involvement that was the reason for the concession of the JR. So, the Scottish Government was content to argue that prior contact in this instance did mean prior involvement during the time of the matters being raised, not prior involvement immediately related to setting out options to complainers directly related to the time of the investigation.
Okay, thanks. And in the same email again, if take you to the third last paragraph. You say, thanks for your engagement with this so far and for stepping forward. This is a moment when we can take action to reset the culture and expectations of behaviour in the workplace, and we're grateful to you for helping inform and shape that response. What does that mean, shape that response?
I think in the broad terms, as we've set out in the rest of the note, that actually responding to the Me Too movement, responding to and creating an environment in an organisation where people could expect a safe environment, expect to work in an environment free from harassment, and actually as you will see in other parts of that email, one of the other options was that she may conclude that she did not wish to submit a formal complaint. And I think what I was trying to convey at that time was whatever decision she chose to take, actually, you know, we would still be able to learn lessons and move forward. So it wouldn't be, you know, kind of without purpose, the fact that she had stepped forward, even if a complaint wasn't pursued.
Okay, and finally, I just want to ask you about your role during the formal investigation. You obviously had an ongoing role as a line manager of the investigating officers. You would routinely do, regardless of what she was doing at any one time. But what was your role? Aside from that, what was your role in the formal complaint phase?
Once the investigation had taken place, I didn't have a formal role in the development of the process of the investigation. I had an ongoing role in terms of providing that support and advice alongside Judith, and as a kind of sounding board along the way, and alongside the Permanent Secretary, particularly as it moved into the later stages, making sure that she had all of the advice she needed in order to come to a decision.
So that when you say a sounding board, I mean that's just your role as the head of people. You would, yeah. And what was your last point of contact with any individual who went on, either of the two individuals who went on to make a formal complaint?
I would need to check that out. I would need to confirm that. Do you mean during the investigation or
yes.
just any
well, just,
point since?
Let's say, when was your last contact with any individual during 2018, let's say 2017-18? When was the last point during that time period that you had contact with either of the two complainers?
I would need to confirm. Certainly, we continued to provide updates to them, so they had a factual update on matters as they were developing during the judicial review. Generally, that was done by Judith, but there were times when I picked up that engagement so that they were kept up to date. So that might have been through to the later stages of 2018, during the judicial review, but I would need to confirm.
Okay, that's fine. Thank you very much, Gunnar.
I have a very specific supplementary from Angela Constance, and then we'll go to Alex Gore.
Thank you, Convener. It's just, Mr. Richards, following up on your remarks to Mr. Whiteman in terms of, you know, the various iterations of the procedure and the grounds for the judicial review being compromised or gave way, whatever the terminology you wish to use. But can you just confirm that you accept that for the purposes of the complaints process, the investigation process, and for the judicial review, at the end of the day, the only iteration of the procedure that actually matters is the final one, and at the end of the day, irrespective of why the judicial review was seeded, the government has to apply its own rules, and it's the role of the civil service to follow the rules, is it not?
Absolutely, it was the final version of the procedure that was the one of that matters. Absolutely agree with that. And I think, as I've tried to set out, we thought we were following the rules. We were interpreting that in line with all other employment policies, where the point about prior involvement is with the matter being raised, not ever having any contact with the complainers. Very often in HR roles, people would know the complainers. Would know people who've come forward. In smaller organisations, that kind of separation just wouldn't be possible, wouldn't be conceivable. So we did think we were interpreting it absolutely in line with the intent.
With which version, though? The final version?
The final version.
Okay. Alex Cole-Hamilton.
Thank you, Convener. Good afternoon, Ms. Richards. Thank you very much for coming back to see us. You mentioned in an answer to Murdo Fraser that Gillian Russell's first contact, as you describe it, with complainer Miss A. I'm just very keen for the committee to understand exactly who in the Scottish Government received the first disclosure from any of the complainers in respect of the concerns about Alex Salmond. So can I ask you, who do you believe it was Gillian Russell that had first contact, or was there another individual in the Scottish Government who'd heard about it beforehand?
I can speak to my state of knowledge at various points in time, and certainly in November 2017, my clear understanding was that Miss A had come to Gillian and spoken to Gillian and Barbara, and it was from Gillian that we were notified.
Okay, thank you. And what knowledge, if any, did you have of the meeting that John Summers, the First Minister's private secretary, had with Miss A on the 20th and 21st of November?
I had no knowledge of that at all.
And when did you first learn of that?
Very recently.
Very recently as well. So, okay. And did it surprise you to learn that somebody that senior had known, but you had not known of their knowledge of the situation?
I suppose my understanding is that it was a confidential conversation, so not really.
Okay. I appreciate that. I'd like to take you back to the email that Mr. Whiteman referred to, which is XX 047, which was sent on the 6th of December, which is the day after you and Miss McKinnon met with Miss A about her concerns and indeed handed her the proposal. There's a note attached in that email. There's two things. There's firstly a sort of table with a range of dates, which I think is the timeline to which you refer to in the email. But there's also then a list of bullet points, which commences at 4, 5 and then 6. And bullet point 6 poses the hypothetical question, what would we say if asked? Have you had any complaints about former ministers? To which you reply, yes. What did you do? And then there's a list of actions there. Encourage people to come forward as part of a wider campaign, gather evidence, review our policy and follow it. But one of those clauses is PermSec informs FM as party leader. And so can you just explain the sequencing of this? I take it this is an analysis of what best practice looks like. This is the steps we need to take in this process rather than what has already happened. And when in that process you would expect normally the Permanent Secretary to inform the First Minister as party leader?
This was kind of a setting out of, you know, these are hypotheticals in terms of what might come forward should we receive the formal complaint. And I think what this is trying to set out is, as the procedure sets out, that there's a point in time in the procedure, once you've been through the investigation, that the Permit Secretary would notify the First Minister if they were the party leader, or if the complaint was about a former minister from another party, that the Permit Secretary would be notifying the party leader of the relevant party. So it was about setting out that process, so, you know, kind of at the very end after the investigation.
The reason I ask about this specifically is that the point before it says, however, raise the allegations to the individual and then ellipses, dot, 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 PermSec informs FM as party leader. That would suggest that that was going to be a synchronised event or suggest that it would be happening around the same time. Mr Salmond was informed of the allegations around him in a letter from the Permanent Secretary on the 7th of March, and yet we have heard many times that the First Minister heard about this was from an approach from a source of Mr Salmond's on the 29th of March. Should the process have seen them informed at the same time, or were things followed correctly to your mind?
I mean, again, these were rough notes at a point in time, right. So I wouldn't read too much into them. I think the raise the allegations point is sort of trying to indicate there's a whole sort of investigation process. It's a bit of a shorthand. I've no knowledge in terms of when the First Minister was or wasn't informed beyond the kind of final stage of the process. So I wouldn't indicate that these were bringing these closer or further apart. It was just trying to narrate some of the stages.
That's absolutely fine. Going back to who knew about the complaints, can you just add, in addition to the four main protagonists within the upper echelons of the government, those being yourself, Barbara Allison, Gillian Russell and Judith McKinnon, notwithstanding the Permanent Secretary, were there any other civil servants at that time of the investigation or any senior members of the SNP or special advisers aware of the existence of the complaints or the investigation as it was being undertaken, to your knowledge?
Not as far as I was aware.
Okay, thank you. Final question then, Convener. Just at the end of the session with Gillian Russell this morning, she intimated to the committee that with the publication or the revelation of the investigation and the subsequent media attention around the investigation in August of 2018, that she received a number of other complaints or concerns from other individuals, which she then referred to the police. Can I ask, were you aware of those at the time, and were you involved in any discussions as to how those might be handled?
I'm not sure if I was involved with any discussions with Miss Russell. I don't recall that. But similarly to Miss Russell, if people came to me, then I also passed them directly to the police at that stage. I think the concern was not to muddy the waters at that point. If the police were looking at matters, then it was important that people just went directly to the police.
Could you quantify the number of people that came to you at that time?
Not sure that I could. I can go away and check that out.
Was it less than 10?
Oh, yeah.
Yeah, so just a small handful of people. Yeah. I understand. Thank you, Convener.
Jackie Bailey.
Very much, and welcome back to Ms Richards. You were fully aware of the contact between Ms McKinnon and the complainants before she was appointed investigating officer, is that right?
Yes.
Yep, and I believe you also told Ms A that Ms McKinnon would be appointed investigating officer weeks before the policy was adopted, is that also right?
I think it may have been a week.
Okay, a week then. You were involved in the development of the policy. You knew that the investigating officer was meant to have no prior involvement with any aspect of the matter being raised, and that the investigating officer was to make an impartial collection of the facts. How was that prior contact, which you knew about, compatible with the policy, which you also knew about?
I think, as I've tried to set out, our interpretation of the policy, our understanding of the policy, the way in which these are interpreted, typically in employment policies, workplace policies, is that refers to engagement and involvement with the matter being raised, not the involvement that somebody may have had in an HR professional role to set out options for somebody.
But it was still the matter being raised, and the courts found against you?
Well, I think as the Lord Advocate set out, the reason that the Scottish Government concluded and conceded the judicial review was not on the matter of prior contact per se. And that was a point that the Scottish Government was prepared to argue.
But it was on the independence of the investigating officer, was it not?
No, I don't think it was. I think it was about the capacity of the Scottish Government to fully evidence the nature of that prior involvement so that they could be clear that it was legitimate. And I think it was the inability to put that whole picture together and set that out very clearly.
So basically you're saying to me in the volumes of paper you eventually disclosed to the Court of Session, there wasn't enough there to justify your view and your interpretation of paragraph 10 of the policy. Is that right?
The decision to concede the judicial review was not my decision.
Okay. Let me move on. The Permanent Secretary suggested to us that she wasn't really involved in the development of the policy, but it was delegated to people like you. But that's not strictly accurate, is it? Because Judith McKinnon told us that you were updating the Permanent Secretary on a very regular basis. How did you do that, and to whom did you report?
I think the committees had, I did send regular update notes to the Permanent Secretary, and I think you've had all of those.
I'm not sure that we've seen them yet.
I think you have. I think
have we?
They were part of
earlier
evidence, but I can check that, but I think you have. The way in which we updated the Permanent Secretary, and again back to that moment of the Me Too moment, was across the whole range of activities. So it was about staff communications, it was about procedural updates, not just the ministerial policy, but also our fairness at work and other procedures. It was about making sure that people felt able to speak and come forward. It was about connecting with other organisations to share good practice. So we were updating the Permanent Secretary across a range of topics. And in terms of the updates that we gave about people coming forward, then that was done at a very high level.
Okay. Can I ask you, the Permanent Secretary also in the same time, I think it was the 8th of September, told the committee that as the decision maker, it would be inappropriate for her to know who the complainers were. That's obviously right, isn't it? That's what she said to us on the 8th of September. So there would be no question, if that was accurate, of her meeting the complainers before, say, the former First Minister was advised of the procedure, would there?
I don't know. I mean, I
you
think it would be... I'm not sure why, once the process had got to particular stages, why that would be... not part of the policy.
Do you know if the Permanent Secretary had a meeting with the complainers, and if so, when?
I would need to check that fact.
Okay, if you could do that and let the committee know, that would be great. Can I return to the issue relating to the police? Because you said, I think, in early August 2018, there was an attempt to persuade the two complainers to make complaints to the police. That was initiated by Judith McKinnon first. Then you would have come in after that.
Our intent was not to convince the complainers to go to the police. Our intent was to understand the view of the complainers, should the Scottish Government need to take that step.
So the Permanent Secretary asked you to speak to the complainers on that basis?
Yeah, to seek their views.
Did you alert the Permanent Secretary to their reluctance?
Yes.
Okay, and when they demonstrated their reluctance, did you ask them to support the Scottish Government in making the complaints?
I think there was some going back to understand if we did refer the matter to the police, would they cooperate with the investigation? I think it was just to sort of understand if we referred it to the police, then obviously they may still have chosen not to cooperate with the police. I don't know whether they gave a specific view on that or not, but I think there were certainly a couple of iterations around that.
Could you tell us? Could you go back and check whether they gave a specific view on that?
Yes.
Thank you. That would be helpful. So can I ask you, whose decision was it to report the matter to the police?
That was a matter for the Permanent Secretary and senior advisers.
Okay. Who are the senior advisors?
I'm not sure I can specify.
Sorry, I just assumed because they were senior, you could tell me, but if you can, that would be good. Was there any informal contact with the police before this?
Not by me, no.
By anybody else?
I think that Miss McKinnon has set out that she had spoken to the police during the development of the procedure to sort of understand processes that you might take when dealing with potential victims of sexual harassment. And I think she sought views in order to answer some questions that the complainers were raising about what a potential police process might look like. But again, that was all done completely hypothetically without any specific information being shared.
So given it was the permanent secretary's decision, the reason I stress this is she couldn't recall this when she was asked by the committee on the 8th of September. I think it was my colleague Alex Cole-Hamilton that asked her. Do we know whether it was the permanent secretary that picked up the phone herself, or did she delegate it to somebody to do?
To do what, sorry, to?
Contact the police.
I wouldn't be able to speak to what the permanent secretary did.
Okay.
I was asked to pass information to the Crown Office, not directly to the police.
Oh, okay, so you reported matters to the Crown Office?
Yes.
When was that?
That was the end of August.
End of August. Okay, thank you. My final question, Convener. The hope of assisting the judicial review so that it didn't come to court was something I believe you were aware of. Is that correct?
I can recall some discussion about whether it was appropriate for the judicial review to continue whilst there was live issues being reviewed by the police.
Okay, who was involved in that discussion? Can you say?
I'm not sure. I mean, I was only kind of very much on the edges of that, so...
Okay, but even being on the edges of it, you would know who was involved in the discussion. Was the Permanent Secretary involved in the discussion?
I honestly don't know. It was mainly a legal discussion, as I recall.
Was the Lord Advocate involved in the discussion?
I don't think I'm able to answer questions relating to the law officers.
Oh, okay. I'm just asking you who was in a meeting.
I don't know if there was a meeting.
Oh, there could have been emails then?
Could well have been.
Oh, okay. But there was a discussion, you're telling us that, in some shape or form, about assisting of the judicial review.
I'm sure that the law officers and others were considering issues and whether there was potential difficulties between
them. Okay, but you were on the edge of that, so you knew about it.
Again, I mean, it's always quite hard to know why and when you know things from when you've been kind of poring over papers. But I do recall me having concerns personally about, kind of potential sort of witness statements and things being shared as part of the judicial review when they were also then being reviewed by the police.
Were you aware whether this was communicated, the potential for assisting, to the complainants by either Miss McKinnon or anybody else?
I'm not aware of that, no.
Okay. Did you get any of Miss McKinnon's update notes to the complainants?
On occasion, I may have been copied in, particularly if we were kind of handing over contact at a particular point in time.
Okay. So you would have been aware if anything in relation to assisting was raised with the complainers?
Not necessarily, but
Okay, thank you very much. Thank you, Convener.
Thank you, Miss Bailey. I must have imagined that I heard about 7 or 8 questions ago. This is my last question, Convener. Maureen Watt.
Thank you, Convener. We've heard in previous sessions of the impetus that was given to developing a procedure by the Me Too movement, and indeed it was UK-wide across the civil service. Was any draft or iteration of the procedure shared with colleagues in Whitehall?
Not by me, but I think that James Hind may have referred to that in his evidence.
Okay, and... Yeah, okay, that's fine. Thanks.
Just a definitely a final question from me. Going back to what we were talking about earlier about the decision maker and the decision that was taken, I think you said jointly with yourself and the permanent secretary about that the draft policy would be shared with the complainers. Can I ask whose suggestion it was initially that this should happen?
I can't immediately recall. I think initially it will have come from the permanent secretary, just in terms of, you know, kind of a wish to test matters as widely as could be done.
Thank you. I did say final question, but I understand that Mr. Whiteman has the final question. Yes, Andy Whiteman.
Thanks, convener. No, I just want one very specific question. Going back to this email YY050 as well, you say in that there's a risk that your name, that's the name of the complainer, Ms. A, could find its way into the public domain. The Scottish Government would not comment or confirm, but would offer you the support and protection within our power. When you say there's a risk that your name could find its way into the public domain, is that just a general statement to cover unknown futures? Or had you evaluated the procedure and identified specific risks therein that might lead to the complainer's name finding its way into the public domain?
It was certainly a wider risk rather than a specific concern. But obviously, as soon as if the initial review, initial part of the investigation identified that there were potential causes of concern that needed to be shared with the kind of accused party, if you like, then clearly at that moment you're passing information out with the bounds of the organisation, and it's no longer, that information is no longer in your control. And so whilst we could do everything within our power to ensure confidentiality whilst it remained within the Scottish Government, clearly as soon as it moves outside the government, you can't offer that same level of protection and control. So it always felt that it was important to be open with the complainers about the limits of action and the limits of protection that we would be able to offer at any one point in time.
And were you satisfied that the risks of a complainer's name being disclosed into the public domain, finding its way into the public domain, the risk of that was negligible whilst it remained within the Scottish Government?
I mean, certainly, yeah. I mean, that's why we did everything in our power to try and maintain that confidentiality and to respect that at every moment.
So that risk was mitigated by limiting the number of people that had access to that information? And thereafter, just a matter of trust, obviously, in the professional integrity of those people. Yeah. OK, thank you.
That seems like us now, so can I thank Ms. Richards for her evidence today? And we'll now have a short break before moving on to the next witness. Thank you, Ms. Richards. Can I welcome John Summers, Principal Private Secretary to the First Minister, and begin by inviting Mr. Summers to take the solemn affirmation. Mr. Summers, please raise your right hand and then repeat after me. I solemnly, sincerely and truly declare and affirm.
I solemnly, sincerely and truly declare and affirm.
That I will tell the truth, the whole truth and nothing but the truth.
That I will tell the truth, the whole truth and nothing but the truth.
And I'll now invite Mr. Summers to make a brief opening statement.
Thank you, Convener. I thought that it might be useful to the committee if I briefly outline my current role as the Principal Private Secretary to the First Minister and Deputy Director of Ministerial Private Offices. I've been a civil servant working in the Scottish Government since June 2004 and was appointed to my most recent role as the PPS in February 2017. I have responsibility for over 150 staff and I have oversight of all ministerial private offices. Specific to my role as PPS, I have responsibility for leading a team of private secretaries within the FM's office. I attend Cabinet as an observer, and I have oversight of Bute House as the official residence. I also have shared responsibility for ministerial security. In relation to the remit of this committee, I would like to reiterate the response of the Deputy First Minister on the 6th of November. That is that I had no involvement in the development of the procedure, nor did I have any involvement in the investigation of any complaints brought under that procedure. Other than carrying out and overseeing the requested searches of the First Minister's private office as part of the commissioning diligence, I had no involvement in the judicial review. In terms of the JR, and specifically the Commission, I was asked on the 21st of December 2018 to search for any documents, emails, text messages or notes using a number of suggested search terms. Neither I nor the private office held any documents that fell within the suggested parameters. However, the request also specified that I should not limit my search if I felt any further terms may produce anything of relevance. On that basis, I declared two calendar entries for the 20th and 21st of November 2017, when I met Miss A at her request. For clarity, in both those meetings, the only people in the room were myself and Miss A. There has been some suggestion that I have not been forthcoming about my two meetings with Miss A in November 2017. I would appreciate the opportunity to briefly address this. On the 20th of November 2017, with the permission of Miss A, I shared the disclosure that she had made to me with my line manager on that same day. On the 21st of December 2018, when asked for the first time to search and disclose any documentation relevant to the commission and diligence, I disclosed those meetings on that same day. On the 29th of October of this year, in response to the committee's letter to me, I again declared both these meetings on that same day for inclusion in the DFM's response to the committee. Other than this, I have not discussed with anyone the identity of Miss A, nor have I discussed the disclosure that she made to me in the 3 years since those two meetings took place. I am clear that at no point did I have Miss A's permission to share that information with anyone else, and so I did not. Finally, I would like to confirm that I had no involvement in the meetings or arrangements of meetings that make up the ministerial code phase of the inquiry. I give evidence to the committee on behalf of ministers and not in a personal capacity. I may be privy to information that is the subject of a contempt of court order. Like all civil servants, I'm also required to respect the government's legal privilege and law officers' convention. Therefore, I may have to stop to seek advice or follow-up questions in writing with detail to ensure accuracy and to comply with restrictions on the government's evidence. I declare that I'm a member of the FDA union. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Mr. Summers. And we'll go straight to questions. And first of all, we'll go to Margaret Mitchell.
Okay, thank you, Convener, and good afternoon, Mr. Summers. Can you confirm who your line manager is, just for the avoidance of doubt?
Line manager at the time was Barbara Allison. I now have a new line manager. Barbara has since retired.
Right, thank you. And can you give a kind of flavour in general terms of your role for Principal Private Secretary to the First Minister, specifically for the First Minister? I mean, you've explained quite clearly the people you're responsible for, all of that, but more specifically what that entails in terms of being PPS to the First Minister.
So I'm not, I would think it's accurate to say, involved in the day-to-day running of the office, but for example, I attend Cabinet. If there are any interactions with the UK government or the heads of devolved administrations, I'll be involved. Any issues of national security, I'm involved in those. Any interaction with the Royal Household, for example. Any issues around the First Minister's security, and also, as I said in my statement, around Bute House, and also the staffing and smooth running of her office.
Okay. And would you sometimes attend meetings in her stead?
No.
No. Would you have responsibility for our diary?
No.
None of that. Is one of your responsibilities to have regular meetings with the Permanent Secretary?
I used to meet the Permanent Secretary just before Cabinet started on a Tuesday, but with the COVID pandemic, we don't meet in person anymore, so that would be the only time I would regularly meet with the Perm Sec. Uh-huh.
And did that happen regularly before the pandemic?
Sure, every Tuesday, yeah.
Okay, and can I ask if these meetings would involve the Permanent Secretary providing an update to you, or for you to relay an update from the First Minister to the Permanent Secretary on anything on various issues or what happened since you'd last spoken to her?
They tended to vary. They're fairly short and informal. We'd maybe talk about the week ahead, what the FM had planned to do, or anything that happened in the past week. They would vary, but usually they would be focused on the business of that week and what was going to be discussed at Cabinet.
Yeah. And can you confirm, when you had these kind of updates, meetings, if the development of the procedure, the complaints or the judicial review was discussed with the Permanent Secretary?
Not with me, no.
Thank you.
Alex Cole-Hamilton.
Thank you very much, Convener, and good evening, Mr. Summers. Thank you for coming to see us. I'd like to take you back to those two meetings with Ms. A, and obviously I accept that you may not be able to answer all of these questions based on jigsaw identification. Did you get an understanding as to the catalyst as to why Ms. A had approached you in the first place?
So I could perhaps give a little bit of background. My PA had contacted me to say Ms. A wanted to meet with me, and when he had asked why, she'd said it was a personal issue. So I had no idea beforehand why I was meeting with her. To be frank, I thought it was about essentially a job. In the course of that disclosure, Ms. A had said to me that there had been an experience in the past that she wanted to share, and she wanted to share it in a way that would improve the organisation and make sure that no one else would have to go through that experience again. She was not making a complaint, but she wanted to assess her options as to how she may best share that. One of those options would be potentially speaking to the First Minister about her experience. And so that's why I can't speak for her, as I assume why she came to me.
So she came to you, given your professional proximity to the First Minister and as somebody who potentially would have the FM's ear on a daily basis?
I think it was more to assess various options, one of them being a discussion with the First Minister. And what did I think about that? I think that's probably...
And what did you respond to that question about when she asked whether she could have a discussion with the First Minister?
I asked if I could, first of all, take advice from my line manager. Very happy to say to the committee I was quite overwhelmed in that meeting. I'd never come across anything like this in my career before. And I asked if she would allow me to quickly that day share that disclosure with my line manager and no one else, to take advice and come back to her the following day. I came back to her the following day and we agreed that she would then speak to my line manager directly, which is Barbara Allison. At the end of the second meeting, I said that if she felt that she was not being taken seriously and no one was listening to her, that she should come back to speak to me, and if she wanted to meet with the First Minister, I would set that up.
And I take it because that subsequent meeting never happened, or there was never an arrangement made with the First Minister, that she was satisfied with the process as was adopted or taken forward?
Well, after that second meeting, I never heard from her again, and I didn't have... The only assurance I sought from my line manager, I think, that week was she receiving the support she needed, and did I have any further role in this? And my line manager said no, I did not, and that she was receiving the support she needed.
Okay. You say, and thank you for your candour, that it was an overwhelming meeting. I can imagine it was very distressing to hear some of those things. Did it occur to you at any point in that meeting that that if these allegations were true, that Mr. Salmond, who was still a private citizen, free, not in any way under suspicion, might pose a threat to other people? And as such, did it occur to you that you might communicate it to somebody within the SNP to suggest that they might have to look at their own protocols about protecting women around him?
No, it's a good question, and I did not occur to me. I think my focus and priority was on protecting her anonymity and confidentiality, and I was clear I didn't have her permission to share her disclosure with anyone else.
So the meeting that also happened on the 21st of November and the 24th of November with Liz Lloyd had no relevance to Miss A. So there was never a disclosure of Miss A's concerns to Liz Lloyd by yourself?
There was never a disclosure of Miss A's concerns to anyone else other than my line manager.
I think that's it for now, Convener. I might want to come back in at the end of things.
OK. Ardo Fraser.
Thank you, Convener. Good afternoon. Mr Summers, you said in response to my colleague Margaret Mitchell that you were not responsible for the First Minister's diary. Can you tell us who is? Is there a dedicated civil servant who is?
We have a diary team, so a diary manager supported by a deputy private secretary and assistant private secretary.
Okay, thank you. And would you normally, in your role, have access to that diary to see what the First Minister's engagements were?
Yes, I would look at it daily, yeah.
Okay. We've had evidence from the First Minister in relation to a meeting that took place on the 29th of March with Mr Jeff Aberdeen, formerly the Chief of Staff to the former First Minister. Were you aware of that meeting taking place?
No.
No. Okay. Were you aware of that meeting was in the First Minister's diary?
I was only made aware of that meeting in the media reporting during the trial.
Right. If that meeting had been in the First Minister's diary, would you have seen it? Would you have been aware of it?
I would have been aware of it, I assume, because we use the... Well, we don't keep any logistical, political or constituency appointments in the First Minister's diary.
Right.
We do use them for scheduling, and then they're usually taken at the diary every 3 or 4 months, I would have seen it. But my understanding is it wasn't a meeting, it was an opportunity. I think Mr Aberdeen was in the fourth floor meeting a colleague and took the opportunity to meet the First Minister. So there would have been no reason for it to be in
If it had been a political meeting, as you say, it wouldn't necessarily have been in the First Minister's ministerial diary.
If a meeting had to be scheduled for any time during the FM's working week, we would have it in the diary.
Okay, thank you. We know from the First Minister's evidence that there were meetings with Mr Salmon on the 2nd of April, the 7th of June and the 14th of July. Mm-hmm. Do you have any knowledge of these meetings?
My first knowledge of those meetings is when the First Minister told me in June 2018, and she then followed up with a formal note to the Permanent Secretary.
Right. And were these meetings in her ministerial diary?
No.
They weren't. And if they had been meetings on government business, you would expect them to be in the ministerial diary?
If there was anything to do with government business, I would expect them to be in the diary.
Okay. Okay. Thank you, Convener.
Jackie Bailey.
Thank you very much, Convener, and welcome to Mr Summers. Having been a minister previously, I understand how important a private secretary is, and indeed a principal private secretary. You would know most of everything that was going on, and indeed in your role would have been close to the permanent secretary too. Is that a fair assessment?
No, I don't think so.
No?
I am particularly close to all the kind of detail. I think I said in my opening statement that I currently have 150 staff spread over 16 teams, and my job, I'm sorry, I'll keep this brief, but my job feels more like two jobs rather than one. I'm the PPS, but also head of, the third largest division in government. And while I try and strike a balance, it's near impossible and probably edges more towards the deputy director role. So it would be impossible for me to be in amongst the detail.
Okay, I accept you won't be in and amongst the detail. Let me put it a different way then.
Okay.
Because most private secretaries, I think, would agree with your description of trying to juggle too much, but somebody has once described it to me as almost like a relationship between a husband and a wife. You know what's going on. Is that fair?
No, I do not. I would not describe the relationship between myself and the First Minister as much as I admire her.
Oh, no, I was meaning in general terms. I wasn't meaning you personally. I was meaning in general terms. That's interesting, though, that you went there. Can I just ask you?
Can I confirm? I don't think it was me that went there.
Oh, it wasn't me either. Can I ask you? You know, this committee wasn't told about your contact with one of the complainers until I think we received a letter from the Deputy First Minister. And why did it take a commission in diligence for the contact to be disclosed to the Court of Session?
So I didn't know who to whom Miss A would have disclosed that she had met with me, nor to whom my line manager would have disclosed. And until that point, there would be no reason for me to proactively give that information. My focus, as I said to Mr. Cole Hamilton, was protecting her anonymity and confidentiality. That was my sole focus.
Okay. You've said there were two meetings, one on the 20th, one on the 22nd.
No, sorry, one on the 20th and one the day after, the 21st.
Ah, the 21st, sorry. Yeah. That's my error. And you told your line manager, Barbara Allison, about this?
Yes.
What was the purpose of the second meeting?
So the second meeting was for me to revert back to Miss A and say that I'd spoken to Barbara Allison and would she agree to meet with her and share her disclosure, and we would take it from there, or rather Barbara would take it from there. Miss A agreed.
Okay. Was there a referral to Gillian Russell from you
I
or Barbara Allison?
Involved. No, I wasn't involved in that.
Okay. We know from an FOI that you were having regular meetings with the permanent secretaries, PPS and Liz Lloyd. Mm-hmm. I understand you're also friends as well as colleagues.
Yes, that's right.
Yeah, and on the 24th, you met James Hind. Mm-hmm. Now, as the First Minister's PPS, you will have been aware that they were all involved in the drafting of the policy. Mm-hmm. Yeah, okay. Are you telling us that you made no mention at all of the meetings with Miss A to the Permanent Secretary's PPS, to James Hind, or to Liz Lloyd?
So I would say two things. Firstly, and I know this is unsatisfactory, I don't recall that meeting on the 24th. Secondly, I can definitively and categorically say I made no reference to the meetings with Miss A at that meeting or to anyone else other than my line manager.
Okay. We know, for example, that when the Permanent Secretary heard about an alleged incident at Edinburgh Airport, she went directly to the First Minister to discuss that. But as the First Minister's PPS, you are her most trusted civil service advisor. You said nothing at all about this meeting with Miss A. You kept it totally to yourself. Didn't even tell the First Minister.
I wouldn't tell the First Minister because it wasn't my experience to share. It would be my first priority. Secondly, had I done that, I would have put the First Minister in a state of knowledge about something she couldn't have taken action upon at that point.
Okay.
In terms of any reference to that, to the First Minister. In June, when the First Minister had told me that Alex Salmond had been in contact and that she wanted to do a formal note to the Permanent Secretary for which I would transmit confidentiality, I told her that at the end of 2017, someone had approached me and made a disclosure, and that I hadn't told her because I didn't have her permission to tell her. And I hope she understood that. And she said she did, and we shouldn't speak about it further.
Okay. Can I touch on diary meetings just very briefly? The diary meeting with Jeff Aberdeen, I understand, was in the diary on the 29th of March, but was subsequently removed. Do you have any knowledge of that?
I am as confident as I can be there was no entry in the diary for that date with Jeff Aberdeen.
Do you know where the meeting was actually held?
According to the First Minister's note, it would have been in Parliament.
Do you know, was it in her office? Was it in
I wasn't
meeting
there,
room?
So I couldn't say definitively. I imagine it would be in her office.
Okay, so it was in her office. Did somebody collect Mr. Aberdeen from reception?
Again, I'm sorry, I don't know. I think if we refer to the FM's note, she said that he was already meeting a colleague.
Okay. No, just curious. And my final question, convener, can I take you to the events of the 23rd of August, 2018? Mm-hmm. That, of course, would have been the occasion where you as PPS would have received a copy of, for the First Minister, a copy of the Permanent Secretary's decision report. That document, or at least part of it, was leaked at the time to the Daily Record. Can you tell us about the circumstances of the leak? And as far as you are aware, amongst the civil servants and special advisers, who had access to the report?
I can't comment at all on the leak. I don't know anything at all about it. There was an investigation taken forward by the Scottish Government where they asked us all to disclose any information we had. I've never seen the decision report. I've seen the letter to the First Minister on the 22nd of August, I think it was, not the 23rd. Yeah. So, no, I couldn't comment any further on that.
Do you know who received a copy of the report? Which civil servants and special advisers?
I wouldn't have been involved in anything to do with that.
Well, would you not be copied in to a minute saying, here's a copy of the report?
I would only be copied into anything that was to be transmitted to the First Minister.
But that was to be transmitted to the First Minister, was it not?
So the letter of the 22nd, is that the Permanent Secretary's decision report?
Yes, that's my understanding.
Apologies, I beg your pardon, yes. So I have seen that.
Okay. So you were copied into that. There would have been other people copied in? Who else would have been copied in?
I don't know. I could go back and check my records, but I
could you? That would be helpful,
of
just
course,
to know
yeah.
who had access to the report.
Yeah, certainly. Yeah.
Thank you very much.
Okay.
Thank you.
Andy Whiteman.
Thank you very much. Welcome, Mr. Summers. Was Ms. A the only person who's ever approached you as in your capacity as PPS in relationship to any sexual harassment complaints in the Scottish Government?
Yes.
Okay. What was your state of knowledge about the formal complaint that was made by Ms. A in January 2018?
I didn't have any knowledge of it.
You had no knowledge it had been made, that's fine. What was your state of knowledge of the development of the new procedure whereby there was an explicit provision for complaints to be made against former ministers?
Well, I'm obviously aware that it was commissioned by Cabinet on the 31st. Contemporaneously, I don't recall, but I know from James Hines' testimony that the inclusion of former ministers was in the guidance, or the procedure rather, from as early as the 7th of November.
So, did you have any role in the development of the procedure?
No.
No. So we have in footnote 31, document YY057, mm-hmm. an email from Private Secretary 1 to yourself with an attachment called Complaints Against Ministers, which mm-hmm. is the document.
Sorry, what date was that, Mr. Whiteman?
Email from Private Secretary 1, 20th December 2017, 1555.
Yes.
So that contains a Word document, which is a work in progress of the new handling of harassment complaints against current former ministers.
Yes.
But why was that sent to you?
So 20th of November, I recall, was the date when the First Minister approved the procedure, and that document includes track changes from the unions. So I don't recall why I asked for it, but it may have been I was asking the Permanent Secretary's office had the unions finalised their input into the guidance. That would probably be the most logical reason.
Okay, and it strikes me as odd that on the day they on the 20th of December, the new procedure was approved by the First Minister.
Yes.
So why were you sent a document that's full of track changes? Quite a mess.
I don't recall, so I can only refer to my previous answer that I assume I was maybe double checking that all the I's had been dotted and the T's been crossed.
Okay. Do you recall going through that document at all and having a look at it and considering any matters within it?
I wouldn't have any remit to do so, nor expertise to offer any value.
Okay. So it sounds as if it just sort of came into your inbox as a routine.
Yes.
Someone felt you should have it.
Or I'd asked for it.
Or you had asked for it,
yes.
But you don't recall asking for it.
I don't recall, I'm sorry, no.
Okay, thanks.
Maureen Watt.
Convener, good afternoon, Mr. Summers. Clearly you've reached the dizzy heights of PPS to the First Minister. Can you tell us a bit about your roles in the civil service before that? When did you join civil service and when did you join private office? And how many ministers have you served?
I joined the civil service in 2004. Initially, I worked in housing under supporting people. I then moved on to the Fast Stream graduate programme and did a number of posts. After that, I was head of drugs policy in terms of recovery. I then moved on to become the First Secretary for Scottish Affairs to the People's Republic of China. I did that job for 4 years before returning. And then 2 months later, I became the PPS, the First Minister.
Okay, so you haven't served for any other ministers then, as private?
In this kind of capacity, never as a private secretary, no.
Okay, that's fine, thank you.
Angela Constance.
Just to follow up on that, convener, Ms. Bailey referred to her own ministerial experience, and of course there are 5 former ministers in this committee, but none of us have ever been First Minister. So I wonder if you could, as things stand just now, give us an overview of how private offices operate. So, for example, the average size of a junior minister's office, you know, the kind of the team in terms of functions around them in comparison to, say, a cabinet secretary, and then that of the First Minister, and you indicated that there was, you know, a diary team that looked after her diary, and there may well be other teams that do other functions.
Sure. So a junior minister would normally have a private secretary at a... I'll talk in grades, but if it doesn't, if you want me to confirm, I'm happy to do that. So they would normally have a B2, which is a mid-level civil servant, as their private secretary, and they would lead a small team, a diary, assistant diary secretary and a correspondent secretary. A cabinet secretary would have a more senior civil servant at a C1 level, leading their office, and they would potentially, if it was a large remit, have a deputy private secretary, and again, a diary and a correspondence. The First Minister has a private secretary and four deputy private secretaries. One of those deputy private secretaries leads the diary team. There's also a correspondence team of two individuals who deal with all the First Minister's correspondence. And we have a visits and events team as well who would lead on any events that the First Minister attends.
So is that about 10 individuals?
For the First Minister?
Yes.
Yeah, approximately between 10 and 12, I think.
Yeah. Okay, thank you.
Alex Cole-Hamilton.
Thanks again for bringing me back in, convener. Going back to the meeting with Miss A, and I understand it was a difficult and traumatic meeting. Can I ask, at the time, did you ask her if she told anyone else what she was telling you?
I don't recall asking her that question.
Did she volunteer that she'd told anybody else?
She had said that she had reported it at the time.
Sorry, to be more specific, did she intimate to you that she was having had the same conversation around that period of time in November 2017?
Not that I recall.
Not that you recall, okay. Did you suggest that she contact anybody else?
Other than referring her to my line manager, no.
Just referring it to your line manager. At any point did the First Minister ask if you were aware of the allegations of... Or did she ask you if Miss A had ever approached you?
I'm sorry, could you...
Did the First Minister ever ask if Miss A had ever approached you?
No.
Okay, that's fine. So we know that you referred her to Barbara Allison. She had went independently, as we've heard in the previous session today, to Gillian Russell. Is it reasonable to assume that if you've got two routes there, one which is an attempt to take it to the attention of the First Minister, and a very understandable thing to want to do, one, to take it to the organisation, to say this is an organisational problem. Is it possible that she might have taken it to someone within the SNP or somebody who might be a bridge to the SNP, like a special advisor, at that time? It's clearly somebody who had something they wanted to say and get into people's consciousness. Do you think that was possible that she might have...
I don't think it? I can comment on speculation. I can't really speak for her. I can only say in terms of the engagement she had with me.
I understand.
And at that point, as far as I understand, she hadn't said she wanted to discuss it with anyone else or had done so.
That's fair. And final question, if I may. Was this the first indication you'd ever had about concerns about the behaviour of Alex Salmond?
So I was aware of the Edinburgh Airport allegation as well.
Okay. And prior to that, were you aware? I mean, we've established several times in this committee there was a low-level water cooler scuttlebutt about bullying behaviour by Mr. Salmond. Were you aware of... that?
So I was aware he had a reputation for being forceful and at times intimidating. The only interaction I've ever had with the former First Minister was in my capacity working in China, where I worked with him for 5 days, and I didn't encounter any of that behaviour. I had no problems or issues.
Okay. Thank you.
Alistair Allen.
Follow up on what you said about the document search that you are in charge of undertaking. Can you just give us a bit of a picture of what that involved and what the criteria were or principles that lay behind it?
So via the PermSex office, with the support of SGLD, they gave us a number of broad terms. So some of them, for example, were permanent secretary, and some of the terms were First Minister. And they asked us to search all documentation we held. I should say private office doesn't hold a lot of documentation. We're always very clear with policy leads that they're the holder of the record. So we did a full search of all our paper records, all records we had on our H drive. I asked the staff who were present, you'll understand the staff at the time were different from the staff earlier on, to check their phones or any other devices that were relevant. And they would come forward to me with a number of papers I would then submit to the lawyers. I obviously knew about my two diary entries that I'd marked private, and I thought they were of relevance. And so I sought advice directly with a member of SGLD to say I wanted to disclose this, but I didn't want to disclose the name of the individual, and how could I do that?
OK, thank you, Convener.
Well, that seems to be conclusion to our questions. Can I thank you very much for coming, Mr. Summers? It's much appreciated. And that concludes the public evidence session, and we will now move into private session.